This morning, how many are ready for the third sermon in the series of this marriage series? How embarrassing for me. Anyway, you know what I meant. How many are ready for that this morning? Okay, let's try it again. How many are ready for the marriage series this morning? Yes, we have a beautiful song this morning, God Bless the Broken Road by Gina Helminiak. So we're going to start out this morning with our theme song that we've been singing for this marriage series called Healing Rain. So if you'll stand with us, the words will be up on the wall, and we will sing Healing Rain.
Sun.
This next song we're going to sing is by Amy Grant. It's entitled Better Than a Hallelujah. And as you're singing the song this morning, really think about the words that you're singing. Better than a hallelujah.
Thank you. Welcome, welcome to Jasper Bible Church. So glad you're here this morning on this beautiful day. The ushers are handing out the Ministry of Friendship books. And if you are visiting with us for the very first time, we are so glad that you are. If you will sign the Ministry of Friendship book along with everyone else, that will give us record of your attendance with us today. And once that book has gone all the way down one end, send it back, if you will, opened up, and it will help you to get better acquainted with those who are seated in your row. Just a few things to share with you. First of all, a note from Mike Still and families. Thank you for your prayers and visits and phone calls during the recent loss of Alan. And continue to be praying, if you will, for the family. I know they would appreciate that. Tonight, a message from Luke 9, a glimpse of his glory. Reminder, teens, we leave at 6:30, and you'll see the information in the bulletin regarding that. We'll get back either by 11 or earlier. Also, next Sunday morning, as we continue the marriage series, we'll be looking at the subject, what Jesus said about marriage. That will be next week. Also, Young at Heart, your next activity is Saturday, November 7th at 6 o'clock, and the sign-up sheets are posted on the bulletin board. And also, you will notice at the very bottom, probably the last time you will see it in the bulletin for this calendar year. Once a month, you know that we have a birthday anniversary calendar that is printed. And we need to, if you would like to be on there and you are not on there, if you will make sure you fill one of those out, put it in the offering plate or in my mailbox next to my office. And we want to make sure that we include you, and just wanted to let you know about that. I think Mike said he had an announcement, so I'll get a microphone for him.
Good morning. Can you hear me? Am I on?
There we go.
Okay, I'll try it again. Good morning. Good to see you, each one of you here this morning. As most of you know, this is the time of the year that we celebrate Pastor Appreciation Month. And because of this basket that I'm holding, from many of you gracious people and our church board, we want to recognize two very special people here that, as many of you know, and I'm sure a lot of us don't know, the amount of time that they spend each and every day, all week long, all year long, the phone calls at all different times of the day. We just thank you guys for all you do for this church, for our family, we want to give back to you. So thank you for what you do for us.
Thank you so much, and it's a privilege to have you put up with this, and thank you. I really appreciate that. Hey, just to share with you some prayer requests as we have our ushers come up for this morning's offering. We have two from our church that had knee surgeries, and both are having some fun with the recuperating process. Be praying, if you will, for Alice Stikes and Georgia Gallant. And Georgia's still in the hospital and put a little thing on, a little note on Facebook this morning saying that she's in some pain today. So be praying, if you will, for her. And Alice was having some challenges as she recuperated at home. And I know they would appreciate your prayers. Lenny Scott recuperating from surgery at home. Continue to be praying for Pat Krishbaum, Francis Reek, Bill Bockert, all recuperating at home as well. Be praying, if you will, for the family of Paul Lay. This will be Becky Scott's dad that passed away. And the services are this afternoon in Wasion. Also, Richard Van Valkenburg is not feeling well today, and I know he would appreciate your prayers as well. We will have the prayer for this morning's offering, and Gina has the offertory special for us, and we will continue on in our service. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I do thank you for each one that's in our service today, the privilege that we have to know Jesus as our Savior, to have our sins forgiven and be on our way to heaven. And We thank you for how you hear and answer our prayers. And we pray especially for Alice and Georgia and Lenny as they recuperate from their surgeries of this past week. Pray there be a good week and there be good progress. And we think too of Pat Krishbaum and Francis Reek and Bill Bockert, that you would bless and meet each need for them. And it'd be a good week of health. Pray also for the family of Paul Lay, and thank you that he put his faith and trust in you. And I just pray that you would encourage the family, and for Richard Van Valkenburg, that you would meet his needs as well. And I think of those who arrived here with a burden upon their heart, and I just pray that you would meet each and every need. Thank you for our country. Pray that those that govern over us would look to you for wisdom and guidance that's found in your word. And I ask your blessing now upon this morning's offering, thanking you for the privilege that we have to give back to you. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you, Gina. What's your chance of getting into heaven? Think about it for a moment. What's your chance of getting into heaven? There's only two possible answers to that question. Either 0% or 100%. If you have sincerely received Jesus as your Savior, and you are trusting in His death on the cross as payment for your sins, then there is 100% chance that you will be going to heaven. No matter what bad things that you've done. Because entering heaven isn't based on your goodness, but upon the goodness of Jesus Christ. Now, if you haven't received Jesus as your personal Savior, and you aren't trusting in Jesus' death on the cross as payment for your sins, there is 0% chance that you'll be going to heaven, no matter how many good things that you have done. Because that decision is based on your works, and there is no way that your goodness matches up to the perfect goodness of Jesus. And that's what it takes to enter a perfect heaven. You understand? 100% chance of going to heaven if you've put your faith and trust in Jesus. 0% chance if you have not. There is no in between. My question is, what's the chance you'll be going to heaven? At this moment, is it 100% or is it 0%? It is one or the other. But if right now, if it's sitting at 0%, it doesn't have to be like that anymore. This is your day. This is the reason why God brought you here today, is to hear that Jesus is the one way to heaven, and the only way to get there is through receiving Him and His death on the cross as payment for your sins. Why should God allow you into His holy heaven? The only right answer is that you're trusting in the perfect work of Jesus to enter God's perfect heaven. And that His blood that was shed for us on the cross is a covering for your sin. If you'll bow your heads, please. I know there are many of you who have already made that most important decision to receive Jesus as your Savior. But I know there are also some who have not. And you need to realize it's one or the other. Either you have put your faith and trust in Jesus and have trusted His death on the cross as payment for your sins, and you are definitely going to heaven, or if not, there's no way in your present condition that you'll be going there. If you'd like to put your faith and trust in Jesus this morning as your one way to heaven, I'm going to give you the opportunity to follow along with me in a prayer, similar to one that I prayed when I received Jesus as my Savior. God knows the sincerity of your heart, and if you'd like to make that decision, follow along with me in this prayer. Heavenly Father, I admit that I have sinned and that I need to be saved. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sins, that He came back to life again. So I receive Jesus as my Savior. I invite Him into my life to forgive my sins so I can go to heaven someday. And Lord, You know those who prayed that prayer with me in the sincerity of their hearts. Please give them the courage to share that with me after the service this morning. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Praise team, if you'll come up again. And we're going to sing hymn number 166. 166, Cleanse Me, all four verses. Before we dig in and turn our hearts toward home, family, and marriage. 166, all four verses, Cleanse Me. Let's stand as we sing, please.
My name is Dan, and I am romantically challenged. Hi, Dan.
Dan, I want you to share your feelings, even though it goes against everything you stand for as a man.
I tried the trick that Jerry taught us last week.
A trick is what a two-bit magician does at a county fair. Jerry was given a technique, and a technique...
Hey, Dr. Phil, let him finish.
So anyway, I decided I'd use Jerry's technique last week, and my wife came to me all exasperated and pulled her hair out and whatnot about her job. And I used Jerry's words exactly. I said, now, honey, what do you want me to do? Do you want me to listen or fix it? And what'd she say?
Listen.
Fix it.
And so anyway, I tried to listen. I really did. But in the middle of listening, I came up with a 7-point plan to fix it. I'm so ashamed.
It's okay, Dan. Hey, you're multitasking, all right? And that is very hard for your untrained one-track man brain to do. Feel proud of that, all right? Who's next?
Hey, I'll go. Hey guys, I'm Jerry, and I'm a, or was, romantically challenged.
Hey, Jerry.
Hey, Jerry.
Hey. Yeah, I actually went through the program, and now I'm a real romantic, according to someone at home.
All right. Okay, Jerry.
Remember when we talked about how we're supposed to love our wives like Christ loves the church? Well, gentlemen, mission accomplished. Okay? This weekend, I saw some extra charges on Cindy's bank card. So, yeah. But I, you know, instead of yelling and screaming like I normally would, I acted in a more Christ-like manner.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I simply turned over her nightstand and her scrapbooking table and said, get out of here, money changer. I was like, get out of here.
I don't think that's what the Ephesians 5 passage means.
Okay. I'm sorry, Bill Gates. Who are you?
No, I think when it says that we should love our wives like Christ loved the church, that means that we're supposed to serve and sacrifice.
Hey, I was cleansing the temple. I was cleansing the temple.
Okay, different perspective, not necessarily right, just different. All right, I think the question is, how many of you have ever done anything for your wife without desiring anything in return? Maybe sitting on the couch, cuddling up to her, watching a movie, maybe The Notebook.
Are you even married?
Jesus wasn't married. Now look, the point I'm trying to... No, I'm not, and that stings a little bit. I have read a lot, well, parts of a lot of relationship books, and if anyone thinks they can lead this group better than I can, put your hand down, Jerry. I am sharing my feelings, and that's what you need to do with your wives. Practice makes perfect. Who wants to go next?
I guess I could give it a shot. Hi, guys. My name is Sheldon, and I am romantically challenged.
Hi, Sheldon.
I thought I'd just share a few things from the program that I've learned so far. First, if your wife says she doesn't know where she wants to go eat, well, that's pretty much code for Italian and expensive Italian. And secondly, if you're getting her an anniversary gift, the Snuggies, not really a very good idea, even if it's the leopard print. Learn that one the hard way. And then third, the simple act of doing dishes is a big, big win. I mean, a big one. So, do all the dishes you can. Thanks.
I have no idea what you said, but that was good. Bathroom break isn't yet.
Sorry, I gotta go. Sorry, guys.
Oh, Mr. Big Guy doesn't want to share, does he?
Not tonight.
Probably doesn't care about his wife.
Okay, I'll share. Okay. This is a picture of my wife and kids. I've been married for 20 years. We married young, and I don't regret it. Have we had our share of storms? Sure. Do we have some amazing memories? Too many to mention. Do I try to fix things? I do. But it's just because after 20 years of marriage, I still want to ride in and be my wife's knight in shining armor. I remember when we got engaged, her father looked at me and he said, just love her the way Christ loved the church. I smiled and said I would, having no idea what that meant. And I still don't know if I understand it. But you know what I want? I want to be a man who wakes up every morning and asks the question, how can I bless my wife? And God, men, isn't that what you want? I mean, isn't your wife worth it?
Hey, wait. Oh, Captain, my Captain?
Sit down, Jerry.
Oh, Captain, my Captain.
Okay, enough. Sit down. What is going on? Sit down. Please, sit down. I need a wife.
And with that, we look at the passage that they were talking about. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. And Jay, if you'll turn me down just a tad. Ephesians chapter 5 and page 1159. 1159. If you're using the Bible that's right in front of you, or if you're seated in a chair, it's right underneath the chair. About two-thirds of the way through the New Testament, Ephesians chapter 5. And we'll be looking at verses 21 through 33 in a message entitled, Marriage as God Intended. Marriage as God Intended. Who else besides me hates to admit it when your spouse is right and you are wrong? Okay, a few brave souls who will testify to that. Now, fortunately for me, it doesn't happen too often, but I got one laugh over in the corner. a few months ago, we needed to travel to downtown Grand Rapids. And over the years, I have drawn, which I believe are the most wonderful maps of how to get to point A, from there to point B. Colorful maps, road guides that I have done by looking at another map, and I have it all set with little arrows going the right direction. But my map was no match for downtown Grand Rapids with all the one-way streets. But Lori's phone is smart. And she suggested that we use a GPS on that phone in order to find our destination, and would you believe that it was far superior to my beautifully drawn maps, and things drastically improved as far as getting around downtown. And so it is with marriage. Marriage can function, but there are ways in which the experience could be so much better. And that is if each partner understood his or her God-given roles and responsibilities. Now, you've heard the claim, I never knew what happiness was until I got married. And then it was too late. You've heard it. And might marriage actually be tolerable? Might marriage actually be enjoyable if spouses would follow God's design? How is a man to behave in a marriage? How is a woman to behave in a marriage? We don't get a good example from the TV shows. Usually it shows the woman as the leader who is using her beauty as power, and it shows the man as a clueless, passive half-wit. Is this God's design? for the roles and responsibilities of marriage. Warning. What you are about to hear may sound outdated. Warning. What you are about to hear may not be politically correct. Are you up to it? It comes from Scripture. And Scripture is never outdated, and it is God who established marriage, and therefore He knows how it works best. And He isn't swayed by sinful man's political correctness. So let's dig in Ephesians 5 and see marriage as God intended. And the first thing we look at would be the roles in marriage. And the first thing that we see is that the husband is the head. Notice beginning with verse 22, it says this, "Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything." And all God's people said, you got to love a verse like this. But God is the one who created us. God is the one who created marriage, and He designed it, if you will see, with the husband as the head of the wife. But this begs the question, before we just jump on with that and close the Bible, what does headship mean? What does it mean to be the head? It certainly doesn't mean that he is smarter or that he has the greater gift in leadership. He may not. What it means is he is the one who is responsible and in charge because he is the one that has to answer to God for the decisions that are made within the home. It's not if he wants to be the head or if he's the better one to be the head. It's not his job to delegate. It's not a privilege that is earned. It is God's design going all the way back to Genesis chapters 2 and 3. So ladies, be very careful who you marry. Know them well enough to know their disposition. Headship doesn't mean that he's more important or that he is superior to his wife. In fact, husbands and wives are co-equal, just as God the Father and God the Son are co-equal. But just as God the Father and God the Son have different roles, so also do the husband and the wife. Notice 1 Corinthians 11:3 says, "But I want you to realize that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of the woman is man, and the head of Christ is God." So if we desire to be obedient to the Lord and to have a marriage that functions well, then the husband must lead. When one man entered heaven, he noticed that there were two lines for the men. One line was for the men who had been dominated by their wives. The other line was for those who weren't. There were thousands of men that were in that line of those who had been dominated. Only one guy was standing in the other line. And Peter asked him, he said, "Why are you standing in this line?" He said, "I don't know, my wife told me to stand here." And the question is, are the roles reversed? And if the husband is to lead, if he is to be the head, what does it mean? Let's look at the Bible. First of all, it means he protects. Verse 25, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Husbands, you should be willing to die for your wives. Now, wives, you don't mind that kind of leadership, do you? First of all, he protects. Secondly, he directs. Notice verse 26. To make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. Husbands, just as Christ is the spiritual leader of the church, you are to be the spiritual leader of your homes and within your family, striving for a family that's without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, holy and blameless. Now here's my question. Husbands, do you, by your example, encourage church attendance, daily Bible reading, prayer, giving, witnessing, and living a life that pleases God? Or does your wife have to nag you? Or even has she had to take upon herself what was not meant for her? Has she had to take upon herself the role of being the spiritual leader within your home because you have dropped the ball? Now, wives, you don't mind having that kind of leadership, do you? It means he protects. It means he directs. We continue on. It also means he provides. Continuing on, verse 28. In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated his own body, but he feeds and cares for it just as Christ does the church. Now, I realize that we live in a generation where there is often two incomes within the household. But it is still the husband's responsibility to make sure that the wife is nourished, both physically and emotionally. Now, wives, you don't mind that kind of leadership, do you? So he protects, he directs, he provides. Now, wives, there's one more, so brace yourself. The husband being the head, it means he decides. Notice verse 24. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Since the husband will answer to God for how he led his family, the final decision on matters is his to make. Now, does that mean that when a decision comes up that he doesn't ask his wife's opinion? Of course he asks her opinion, and he genuinely thinks it through. Anything less would be both rude and stupid. And if the wife's idea is best, which by the way could be 100% of the time, but if the wife's idea is best, then he gladly decides to go with her idea. But if he decides differently, it is a sin for the wife to subtly seek getting even, whether it's through the silent treatment or withholding physical intimacy or, the worst ever, purposely leaving off the jelly from a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. Men, if your role is to be the head, to protect, direct, provide, and decide, then what's the role of the wife? The wife is the helper. Now, ladies, before you have roasted Bruce for lunch, I want to explain to you what is meant by that word helper, because it is rich in meaning. In fact, we looked at it last time in what God said to Adam. Notice Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. The Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper," referring to Eve, "suitable for him." The Hebrew word for helper, it's rich in meaning, and it means this. It means to come alongside of and encourage wherever he has a need. Say, well, that's a long phrase. Yeah, actually, it takes two Greek words to convey that meaning. The first Greek word is ba'itheia. Ba'i means a cry. Theia means to run. Literally, to run to the cry. And it's a word that's used in Hebrews 4:16, referring to Jesus. Notice Hebrews 4:16. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace, here it is, to help us in our time of need. Ba'itheia. Just as Jesus has come to help us where we have our needs, we see that that is the role of the wife. Now, the second Greek word is parakletos. Para means alongside of. Kletos means to call. So literally, to call alongside of. It is the title that Jesus gave to the Holy Spirit in John chapter 14 and John chapter 16. In the King James Version, it's translated as comforter. In the New International Version, it's translated as counselor. And just as Jesus sent the Holy Spirit to comfort and encourage and help the Christian, so also that is the role that the wife has in encouraging her husband. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 9 says, "Neither was man created for woman, but woman for man." So it isn't a second class anything. Sometimes when we think of helper, you may not think of that as being a grand role, but it's the same role that Jesus has toward us, and it's the same role that the Holy Spirit has toward us. So it's not a second class anything. Now, what I've just mentioned from Ephesians may not be politically correct, and in 2015, it may not be looked at as the thing of the day. But God's word's not up for vote. And you'll also notice that there are no limitations when it comes to female leadership in politics or business. This is a marriage issue here. So ladies, you don't have to go through that if you can't handle that role of marriage. God gives you the option of staying single if you like. Here's my question. We're going to have some questions here for you to think about. Wives, do you live your lives to help yourself, or do you live your lives to help your husbands? And I dare you to ask your husband this question this week. Ready? What kind of help do you need? And also, am I really, truly helping you? Now, in some homes, the wife might be the best one to be the treasurer because perhaps she's better with finances and budgeting. I know in our home, Lori is absolutely amazing with fixing things. She is a carpenter. She is mechanically minded. I'm mechanically challenged. I can't figure it out. I am amazed on how she is able to do the different things and fix the different things and repair and construct, and it is absolutely amazing. We look at this, and I know that some of you ladies might be moaning, and you might be saying, well, isn't this husband headship thing and this wife helper thing a license to be treated like a doormat? Not in God's plan. Because with these roles, also, we see the responsibilities. Notice verse 33, the responsibilities are given. However, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. Notice that, first of all, the husband's responsibility is to love his wife. The wife's responsibility to respect. And not surprisingly, this would be exactly meeting what each needs the most. You see, the wife's greatest need is security and intimacy. And agape love meets those needs. There are three different words for love that are used in the Bible. The one that's used here is not eros, which has the idea of a physical attraction or lust. It's not the word phileo, which has the idea of a friendship or family kind of love. But it is the word agape, which means a sacrificial love. Agape love is unconditional, forgiving shortcomings as God forgives us. Agape love is unending, not a temporary romantic thrill, but a lifelong commitment. Agape love is unselfish, meeting her needs as Christ has met our needs. Agape love is unchanging, not kind when you're dating and then caustic when married. And such love, if put into practice, would meet those needs of security and intimacy. Now, the husband's greatest need is respect. He needs someone that is going to be an ego builder rather than an ego chopper. What I'm going to tell you next, you could spend $100 hearing somebody say, but out of the kindness of my heart, I'm giving it to you for free. Wives, if you make your husband feel good about himself, then he'll want to be with you. He'll want to spend time with you. Because what he needs is the respect and the ego building. If you make him feel good about himself, he'll want to spend time with you. Why won't you spend any time with me? If you make him feel good about himself, he'll want to spend time with you. And wife, by the way, God is not holding you accountable for your husband's decisions, but for your submissive attitude. Now we look at this, and we see in verse 31 that it says, if both the husband and wife will leave his father and mother and be united to one another, then the two will become one flesh. How many are familiar with Gary Chapman's book, The Five Love Languages? Okay, actually, maybe close to half of you or so. According to his book, he says there are five love languages: words of affirmation, quality time, receiving gifts, acts of service, and physical touch. And according to Chapman, the secret of keeping your spouse's emotional love tank full is to discover your spouse's love language, and then you show your love to your spouse by filling their tank. Now, maybe what fills your tank is acts of service when your spouse is doing things for you. So in your mind, you automatically assume that your spouse has the same love language as you do. So you're trying hard to show love by fixing the house, by washing the car, by doing the laundry. And yet they still feel empty. Perhaps your spouse has a different love language of quality time or words of affirmation. And we need to be sensitive to what it is. Now, how do you know what your love language is? Fill in this blank. I feel most loved by my spouse when I feel most loved by my spouse when. And you can tell when you fill in the blank if it's more words of affirmation, quality time, receiving gifts, acts of service, or physical touch. And I double dog dare you to ask your spouse this question this week. What makes you feel most loved by me? That will help you to get a better understanding of what your spouse's love language is. Now, I realize that this works best when one or both of the couple is not self-absorbed and actually has the desire upon their heart to please their spouse. But it can be of great help. Discover your spouse's love language. And then use it as a conversation piece and have fun showing love to one another. But you may say, you don't understand. That sounds like a fairy tale to me. You don't understand what goes on between the four walls of our home. Perhaps, like Rodney Dangerfield, just say, my wife and I were happy for 20 years, and then we met. And maybe you're saying, Pastor, you don't know how hard I have tried and for how long I have tried to change my spouse. I really have, Pastor. I really tried to change my spouse. I have two words for you. Quit it. That is not your job. That is God's job. We can't change people. But as we allow God to change us, then our spouse is more likely to change in response. We need to learn from the clever lawyer. He was approached by a man who wanted to divorce his wife. And the wise lawyer said this, let's get her good. What I want you to do is for the next 2 months, I want you to treat her like a queen, okay? What you can do, you take her out for dinner. You buy her gifts. Spend time with her. Communicate with her. Compliment her. And then in 2 months, tell her you want a divorce. Oh, you'll get her good. You'll nail her. She'll be so shocked. And he said, yeah. So he went ahead. And he did just that. 3 months went by. And the lawyer saw this guy at the store. And he asked him, whatever happened to the divorce? You never came back. And the man said, divorce? What do you mean? I'm married to a queen. People are often what we make them to be. And if we will make a conscious, sincere effort to fill the love tank, the emotional tank of our spouse, could make a big, big difference. Now, here's my challenge for you. What if you, as a husband, as a wife, this week, instead of trying to change your spouse, made a conscious effort to discover their love language and fill their tank? You say, well, it's just too awkward to sit there at home and say, what's your love language? So I have a solution. As you leave today, I have a test that the husband can take. I have a test that the wife can take. I use this for premarital counseling as well. And you can tell, and you can actually score it right on your sheet. You can tell what your love language is. You don't have to say a word. You can fill out that sheet, and you can hand it to each other and say, here you go. And you can look at it, and you can be maybe surprised, or maybe you knew all the time. And instead of trying to change your spouse, say, I am going to spend this week discovering the love language of my spouse, and spend this week doing that which fills the emotional tank. It could make the difference in your marriage that's struggling right now, in your marriage that's barely being held together. Will you try it? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I do thank you for God's word. Written so long ago, but has the instruction that we need. May we apply it to our hearts today. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Praise team, if you'll come up. They're going to lead us in what we have used as a theme closing song. I believe it's written by Stephen Curtis Chapman. His strength is perfect. Love language. Remember, I have copies to give to you. You can't beat the price. They're free till noon. Why don't you try? You might say, you don't understand. We come to church and we put a smile on our face and we act like things are well. Things are not good. Things are not good at all. Are you willing to try it God's way? Give it a try. Give it a try. It's worth it. Give it a try. As always, the invitation is open. Let's stand as we sing, please.
Sometimes the one who I need can do through me.
so glad you could be here this morning. I hope you felt welcome. Remember now, I'll be in the foyer. I'm bearing gifts. Can't beat the price. And I hope each couple will take one and take one home with you. And it could be the start of a fresh start within your home. If you'll remain standing for closing prayer. And Rick, if you close the service in prayer, please.
Let's pray. Father, thank you for the message this morning. And I just pray that you'd help us as husbands and wives, men and women, just to lead our lives in the way that your word gives us, that we can follow every word that's in your book, to do the right thing and to live our lives that would be pleasing to you. Thank you so much that your only son died on the cross for each of our sins, that through that blood that was shed there, we have eternal life to look forward to. Thank you so much for loving us that much. As we leave here this morning, just bless us, give us strength, and help us to keep our eyes on you and doing the right things always because you love us. Thank you again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And we are dismissed.